unless we had some teens testify this morning. So I'm going to go ahead and ask Natalie and Joe and Madeline if they would come up. They're going to share their testimonies this morning. So would you welcome them as they come up to the stage? Come down here a little bit. Sure, same order. Is that okay? All right, this is Madeline. Madeline's going to go ahead and go first.
Okay. Hi. I'm a lot less nervous this service than last service. Well, when I went to camp, I really wanted to be changed. Like, that was, like, the big thing for me. I really wanted something to change. And I kept telling myself I didn't know what that was. But I guess I thought I did because I kept seeing people break down crying and feeling God's presence. And I wanted to feel that. And I thought I kept trying. And I'm like, I don't think I'm going to be changed here. And maybe this is just not my gear. And then I went home and, like, had some time to think about it, and then I realized I was changed. And it was in the most unexpected way. When I was 7, my parents got divorced because my dad made some really bad choices, and he really, like, betrayed my family, and I was really angry at him for that. And I never let go of that anger. I just let it build and build until I hated him completely and actually did hate him. And then I went to camp, and camp was the first time I called him Dad instead of just his first name. And it was the first time I admitted that I actually loved him. And I went home and I realized I'd meant it. And that was the craziest moment of my life, because it's taken me like 6 years to forgive him, but it took me only 5 days to go from hating him to loving him again.
Amen.
So that's really all I wanted to say.
Awesome job, Madeline. We're so proud of you. We love you. Joe, I'm going to go ahead and have you share a second.
Hi.
Hi, Joe.
So last year at camp, when we came back, I think a lot of us went back into, like, the toxic and negative relationships and friendships that we had. And I think that camp high that we had last year just really died out. And I don't want that to happen this year. I want us to come back next year and talk about how 2022 was our year. That was our year. You know, that was the year where everything changed. And, that's how it was last year. But I think the biggest thing for me this year was just learning how to forgive and move on. Because I think I was, like, stuck in just, I was trying to balance this life where I would come into church and then worship God, and then I would come out and go talk to these people that I shouldn't be hanging out with, that I shouldn't be talking to. But I think that's what God really spoke into my life this year at camp, because I think when Pastor Mayo said, like, the worst thing that happens, we go to heaven, like, we all thought of that as, like, a joke and, like, a little catchphrase, but he was, you know, really speaking life into us, because we need to just stop, worry about what other people think of us and just start worry about what God thinks of us and how we need to move in people's lives.
Awesome, Joe. We're so proud of you. And then lastly, we're going to have Natalie share this morning.
Hey, guys. Okay, good morning.
Good morning.
Sorry, my paper's all crumpled. Okay, I guess I kind of walked into camp this year kind of angry at God, and I was hoping I was going to get an answer because I had so many questions for God, you know? And I guess I just walked in angry, frustrated, wanting an answer and wanting to not be mad at God, you know? And I did not get that, and I didn't get those answers, and I'm not mad anymore, because one thing I realized at camp was someone saying basically that God, he won't leave you comfortless. He's literally God's not going to leave you comfortless. He's going to comfort you with his own blanket. And I guess something like that just really stuck, I guess. That was a big takeaway for me from camp, especially everything in my life, because I've been through a lot. And I don't know how I'm here smiling, laughing, standing here, singing on stage, but but I'm here. So I'm grateful for that. And yeah, my biggest takeaway was hearing that. And then another takeaway I have from camp was the worship sessions, where you can't tell if it's sweat or tears running down your face. And just hearing those words come from Pastor Mayo was just crazy. It was like, okay, and it doesn't sound like that much, but when you're in the moment and you're crying and you're sweating and you're worshiping, in the moment, it felt like I got struck by lightning. Like, I was frozen. I was like, that's true. And so I went back and I read it, circled it, highlighted everything. And another thing I heard was one morning at camp was that God will throw obstacles that lead you down the road to success. And that was probably a big takeaway for me, because sometimes we don't understand why God does things, and we might not ever understand, but I guess hearing that was just a big takeaway for me. But yeah.
Awesome job. We're so proud of you and all the rest of our students. You guys can be seated. Well, as they were talking about Ignite Camp, we got back from Ignite Camp a few weeks ago. Last year, we sent 23, I think, and this year we sent 41, so we almost doubled in how many students we shared. So I'm so proud of them, but I wanted to give you guys an opportunity to kind of check out what they experienced when they were there. So I have this cool clip that I want you to check out.
Paradise on Earth.
Begins to happen when over 500 students gather in an auditorium and start praising God. I mean, I remember the first time last year when I saw that, I was moved completely to tears seeing them all surrender to the Lord. So it's a special, special time that we all get to experience. Well, let's go ahead and get into God's Word this morning. We're going to be reading from 1 Samuel chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. 1 Samuel chapter 3, 1 through 10. Says, the boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There were not many visions. One night, Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was lying down in his usual place. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the house of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called Samuel, and Samuel answered, "Here I am." And he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me?" But Eli said, "I did not call. Go back and lie down." So he went and laid down. And again, the Lord called Samuel. And Samuel got up and he went to Eli and he said, "Here I am, you called me?" "My son," Eli said, "I did not call. Go back and lie down." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. And a third time the Lord called Samuel, and Samuel got up and he went to Eli and he said, "Here I am, you called me?" And then Eli realized that the Lord was calling the boy. So Eli told Samuel, "Go and lie down, and if he calls you again, say, 'Speak, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and laid down in his place, and the Lord came and he stood there calling at the other times, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel got up and he said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." The title of my message this morning is Listening Like Samuel. Listening Like Samuel. Well, as we've been talking about Ignite Camp all this time, I thought, what not a better time to share an experience that we had in my high school girls' cabin. Yes, I said high school girls. Oh, it was lovely. So one night, it was towards the end, it was really late, and everybody was asleep besides Jenna and I. And we were up in her bunk talking and giggling. We didn't know how late it was getting. We just knew it was late. And out of nowhere, we heard the cabin door creak open. And I thought, oh, no. And we see flashlights start shining in. So I got a little worried. I thought we were in trouble or something for still being awake. I mean, I thought they were coming in to make sure everyone was asleep. So I see these flashlights and these people are making their way to the back of the room. So I told Jenna, I said, "Shh, scrunch down in your bed. Let's act like we're asleep." So we scrunch down real low, and then the people come with their flashlights, and one of the camp leaders, when I peeked over, I realized that it was the head camp counselors coming in. And so I peeked over the bunk and I heard one of them, her name's Brooke. She said, "Where's Devin?" And I thought, oh no. I'm in deep doo-doo at this point. What kind of counselor stays up till 2 o'clock in the morning? So I peeked over the bunk, and I said, "I'm up here." And she said, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm just cuddling with my cousin Jenna. Like, it's all good. Like, we're good. We're asleep. It's fine." And her response was a little bit different than what I had anticipated. I thought she was going to say, "Well, you need to get out of her bunk and let her go to sleep because it's 2 o'clock in the morning." But instead, she just looked at us, and she said, "Okay." Weird. And so I was like, okay. And then when she said okay, she looked down at one of our girls, Mackenzie, who was sleeping on the floor on her mattress. And she looked at her and she said, "Can I wake her up for a video?" And I looked, I said, "It 2 o'clock in the morning and you want to wake a high school girl up for a video? I mean, if you're waking her up and not me, that's all on you. I'm not doing it." And so she said, "Okay, I'm going to do it." So she got down real close to Mackenzie. She got down real close and she tapped her and she said, Hey, wake up. Can you sing me a song?" Oh, me and Jenna were up there giggling, thought we were going to pee ourselves. It was so funny. And so we're sitting there laughing. And so Mackenzie wakes up and she's looking. She can't figure out where the flashlights are coming from or who's talking to her. And so she looks at her and she goes, "Happy birthday to you." Oh, my goodness. And she sang happy birthday. It was so funny. And Brooke was so determined that she wasn't going to leave there without Mackenzie singing a song in her sleep. And you know, that kind of reminded me of the story of Samuel and Eli. So to give you some background, the Bible tells us about a woman named Hannah. Now, Hannah was barren, which means that she couldn't have any children. So she prayed and prayed and pleaded with the Lord and said, "If you would give me a child, I'll dedicate his life to serve the Lord." And so God ended up blessing her with a baby boy named Samuel. And after Samuel was born, she remembered the promise that she had made to God. So she took him when he was old enough to the tabernacle and presented him to the high priest Eli to be a helper to him. So here we are, so many years later, Samuel and Eli are asleep in the tabernacle, and Samuel's about, I think he's about 13 years old at this point. So here's Samuel, wrapped up in a sheet of blanket. I'm going to embarrass myself for a minute. He's all laying down in a sheet of blanket. It's like 2 o'clock in the morning, right? And he's sleeping, and he's sleeping, and then all of a sudden he hears, Samuel, Samuel. So he gets up, and he's like, whoa, what's going on? So he runs over to Eli, and he says, Eli, you called me? And Eli says, no, I did not call you. Go back to bed. So then he goes back to bed, and he's like, okay. So he lays down, and he's fallen asleep again, and he hears it again, Samuel, Samuel. So he gets back up, and he's like, what's happening? And he goes to Eli, Eli, you called me? And Eli says, no, I did not call you. Go back to bed. So he lays down again a third time, and he hears it again, Samuel, Samuel. So he gets up, and he goes back to Eli, and in that moment, Eli realized it was the Lord calling him. So Eli told him exactly what to say if it happened again, but he said, just go back to bed. So Samuel goes back to bed, and he's laying down, and he hears the Lord call him, Samuel, Samuel. So he gets up, and he says exactly what Eli told him to say, speak, for your servant is listening. That was four separate occasions, four separate times that God persisted in calling Samuel, four separate times that God pursued him, which leads me to my first point today, that God's call is persistent. God's call is persistent. Just like when Brooke got down real close to Mackenzie wanting her to sing a song in the middle of the night, it kind of took her a minute. You know, Samuel did the same thing. It took him a minute. He didn't answer God the first time. He got a little confused. He didn't understand what was happening. I mean, here Samuel is, a 13-year-old boy who God was calling to be a prophet. God was calling him to deliver his message to his people, a calling that seems to be too big for a 13-year-old boy to even comprehend. And, you know, Samuel didn't have anything mapped out for him. He didn't have the details. In fact, I really don't think he was given any. He simply had an encounter with God in which a calling was placed on his life. You know, how many of you know that God is not always a God of detail, right? He may give you the beginning and the end, but he doesn't always reveal to you the in-between. You know, my pop-up once told me, if you're waiting for all of the details, you could be waiting your entire life. God doesn't always reveal to you the in-between. And he didn't with Samuel. He didn't give him detail, but he persisted. The calling that God had on Samuel persisted. It didn't let up. It didn't ease. It wasn't weak, and it wasn't soft, because when God calls you to something, it's strong. You'll feel it everywhere you go. It's not going to let up. It's like a dog with a bone or my dog with paper towels. Now, guys, I have a 4-year-old golden retriever. His name is Nuggies. Yes, Nuggies. I named him after a chicken nugget because that's my favorite food. And he's awesome. I love him. But he'll do anything for paper towels. Like, he'll jump up on the table and get them. He'll take them out of your hand. He'll take them out of the trash can. The dog loves some paper towels. He's persistent in getting what he wants. And God's calling for you is the same way. God's calling on your life is going to be persistent until it's recognized or until it's fulfilled. He's not going to let up. He's not going to stop. He's going to chase after you until there's no place you can hide, because when God calls you, he calls you persistently. And that leads me to my second point this morning, that God's call requires response. God's call requires response. You know, one night a few months ago, we were all home asleep, and all of a sudden at like 1 o'clock in the morning, all of the fire alarms in our house start going off, like the obnoxious beep, 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 like wouldn't stop. So my mom and dad and I jump up, and we're frantically running around to try to figure out what's happening, and I just book it for the front door. Like, if there's a fire, I'm the first one out. Like, you won't see me. And so then when I realized that there wasn't a fire and everything was okay, they just were going off for some reason, I kind of walked back upstairs, and we were walking around trying to figure out where the noise was coming from and why it was going off. We were running towards where the sound was coming from to try to figure out how to stop it. And in a way, Samuel was doing the same thing. He was running to the one who he thought was calling him. He kept running to Eli, but God persisted. It wasn't Eli that required a response, but it was God. You know, God persisted until Samuel answered his call, until Samuel acknowledged him. And what I love about this story is that you notice that Samuel didn't sleep through God's call. You know, he got up as soon as he heard it, and he searched and he went to where he thought it was coming from. He was hungry for it. He felt something different in his spirit, something nudging him to go. God's call required Samuel to respond. God's call in your life is going to require you to respond. It's going to require action. It's going to require you sometimes to get down on your knees and say, "Here I am, God, send me. God, use me. God, who can you lead to me? God, I'm yours." That's when he's going to do the greatest work in your life, is when you're down on your knees and surrender to him. You know, last year, we went to Ignite Camp, and I took my girls on this thing called a ropes course that they have at the camp. And a ropes course is like this huge obstacle course, like 30 feet above the ground in the trees, and you get harnessed in and hooked to like a zip line, and you walk through the ropes course. You're harnessed in, so you're not going to fall, but you're walking through tight ropes and tunnels, and it's pretty cool. But I had a student last year that got halfway out there and started to have a panic attack. And so the people that were running the ropes course said, "We don't have enough here to get to her. Can you go out to her?" And I said, "Sure." So when I got out to her, she was crying and she was just hyperventilating. And I encouraged her that she only had to take one step at a time. That looking at the entire route she had left looked overwhelming. But when you just take one step at a time and look at the small steps in front of you, it becomes accomplishable. So I told her, we stood there, and I held her hand, and I said, "Okay, one, two, three, step." And we wiggled a little bit. And I said, "One, two, three, step." And we wiggled a little more. And I said, "One, two, three, step." And we wiggled all the way, taking one step at a time until we reached our destination on the other side. See, it was in her response. It was after she said yes to go on the ropes course that she got stuck in tribulation, where it became too much to look at the route left ahead of her. See, what I'm trying to tell you this morning is that not only is God interested in your destination or where he's called you to, but he's interested in teaching you along the way until you get there. You've got to take one step at a time in response to where, who, or what he is calling you to. God's call is going to require you to respond. And that leads me to my third point this morning, that God's call is purposeful. God's call is purposeful. God called Samuel intently and purposely to live out his calling as a prophet. You know, in our lifetime, God may call us to so many different things. It's not just one, and oftentimes we get confused about that. God's going to call us to so many different things, to help people, to pray for people, to serve, to forgive, to step out, to love. But what I really want you to get this morning is this. But what God has called you to and what he has for you is for you. God gave you the opportunity. God gave you the genetics. God gave you the skills. God gave you the ability. God blessed you. God anointed you. What God has for you is not negotiable. It is just that for you. He has created you with a purpose. And it doesn't matter what people may say or what people may do, because what God has for you is for you. And nobody can take it from you. You know, in the beginning of last year, I pray this every year in January, that God would just give me a word or a phrase or something to cling to that our students need to hear throughout the year. And I kept hearing the word purpose, purpose, purpose. Everywhere I went, purpose, purpose, created with a purpose, 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 created with a purpose. And the reason that I picked the saying "created with a purpose" for our t-shirts and our sweatshirts that they have on is that so many students have come to me and have asked, "What purpose does God have on my life when I'm only 14 years old? What purpose does God have for me right now?" And my response to them has always been the same. I've always told them this: your number one purpose in life is to serve God and lead others to him. And we don't need to make that difficult. It doesn't have to be this big, extravagant plan, right? We just simply need to ask ourselves, where in our life can God use us as a disciple to spread the name of Jesus? Because that's what it's all about. It's all about spreading the name of Jesus and the love that he has for us and what he's done for us. So I've told them over and over again, serve God, lead others to him. Where can God use you in your life? And the reason that I'm sharing that today is because I don't believe middle and high school students are the only ones that ask themselves that question. What's my purpose? You know, before I was connected in youth ministry, I prayed and prayed and prayed with God that, you know, I knew he put me on this earth for a purpose, but I didn't really understand what that was at 19 and 20 years old. You know, I'm a student going to college, studying elementary ed. Like, what do you want me to do now, God? I'm kind of bored. I mean, where can you use me? Where can you send me? You know, I prayed for, I think it was 4 months before God led me here. Because how many of you know God's not always an Amazon Prime God, like I like to call it, where you pray and the blessing shows up at your doorstep? That's not always how it works, right? It took me 4 months of listening for God's call. It took me 4 months of me praying for God to lead me, 4 months of complete surrender down on my knees that God sent me here. It was through me intently listening for God and getting connected in church to serve him first that he did his greatest work in my life by allowing me to lead our teens. You know, the call that God has on your life is so purposeful. If there's a reason that he leads us to what he does, that he calls us to what he does, that he calls us by name just like he called Samuel, Samuel, he's calling you by name. And it's time to lean in like Samuel and listen for him. So what I want to leave you with is this today. When is the last time you said, God, what can I do? God, who can I lead to you? When is the last time that you simply listened for the Lord to call? When is the last time, like Samuel, you said, speak to me, God, here I am. God, lead me. God, I'm yours. When is the last time you asked yourself that question? Let's pray this morning. Father, we thank you for this beautiful Sunday morning, God, that you blessed us with. God, I thank you for what you're doing in the life of the church and in our individual lives. And God, as we go into this week, we know we may get distracted. God, we know things are going to get busy. God, things are going to get chaotic. But God, would you help us listen for your call? Would you help us listen for your voice? Would you help us intently listen and follow to where you are? God, I thank you for what you're doing in the life of our students. God, what you're doing in the life of our youth ministry, God, is simply amazing. And God, we thank you for what you're doing and what you're going to do. But God, I pray that you would continue to send more and more students. God, that there would be a flood every week. God, that you would send a revival, God, that the light wouldn't burn out 2 weeks from camp, God, but that light would carry them around till next year. God, we thank you for what you're doing. We thank you. We love you. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.